Time travel commencing in T-minus 10 seconds and counting.
It's once again time to go back in time as we head back to the future on the WDW News Today podcast. Let's set our time coordinates for this week's trip through Disney Parks history with Professor Tom Corliss.
It's time to go back.
Where, Tom? Where?
Oh, it's time to go back to the future, Ron. That's right. To better understand where the Disney parks are heading in the future, we need to look back at classic attractions, current favorites, and everything that got blown up at Disney's Hollywood Studios. Joining me for this special Disney's Hollywood Studios Appreciation Week edition of Back to the Future is, as you already heard, Ron Deanna.
Huh?
Jason Diffendahl.
Hey, howdy, hey.
David Smith.
Hey, everyone.
And we got Michael Batista doing the audio and the video for all you people watching on YouTube.
Yeah, I'm here too.
Yep. There you go. And tonight, because we are celebrating the history of Disney's Hollywood Studios all week long, we're looking back at one of the few, the opening day attractions of the Disney-MGM Studios at the time, or the Studio Backlot Tour. So that's where we're journeying this time. Is everybody ready to punch in those time coordinates?
Yes.
Very excited. Everybody.
Punch it.
He's very punchy. That's what the bulldozers did. They were like, punch it and forward, right through everything. All right, well, we're actually going back. We're going back farther than we've gone in many, many a segment. We're going back to August of 1923. Yes, it's when Jason was born. No, I'm joking. I was 24. In August of 1923, a kid from Kansas City, Missouri, who had just moved to the West Coast, had finagled his way into getting a lot pass to Universal Studios. Yeah, this is before they had Fast and the Furious, by the way. The kid's name was Walt Disney, and after acquiring this pass, Walt would spend 3 days exploring the lot at a Universal City until the security guard finally got suspicious and demanded that he relinquish that pass. Of course, this is way before Disneyland was even a thought in Walt's mind. He hadn't achieved much success in Hollywood. In fact, he had really just arrived at that point. But Walt had seen the Universal Studio tour in Hollywood and wished, once his studio was established, he wished to have a backlot studio tour to run through the Walt Disney Studios in Burbank. But for a number of reasons, that could never be accomplished. And as Walt toyed with the idea, he then began planning instead a small park across from his studio. And as Walt and his team came up with more and more to add to this park, it quickly became too big for Burbank, California, and the local roads would never be enough to handle the car traffic he envisioned. Mind you, Burbank, even now, far more established than it was then. Burbank was not a very big town, and the highways weren't built up at that point. Certainly they are now. Still, Burbank's a little out of the way, but it's, you know, it's still kind of part of the city at this point. This would lead Disney to purchase some orange groves in Anaheim, California to host his vision. And of course, Disneyland was born, and the rest, as they say, is history. But all of this comes out of the backlot tour. Walt always wanted this backlot tour around the studio. And then suddenly that backlot tour grew into this park idea on a lot behind the studio. And then it became Disneyland. So Universal and this idea of a studio tour is really important in the genesis of all of the Disney theme parks. And everyone agreed. Great. I'll move on. In fact, as Roy Disney was trying to acquire funding for Disneyland, he told many investors that if the park did not meet expectations, they would use the Hollywood-style sets of Main Street, Adventureland, and Frontierland for the filming of movies and television shows. So if Disneyland didn't work out, They were not going to just bulldoze it. They were going to make sure they got their money's worth out of it. So in a way, Disneyland would have become the first ever working studio theme park way back in 1955, which makes sense because all this everything was built with forced perspective and all these tricks that were in the used in the movie making industry at the time. And so these things would have been great backdrops. Like, sure, they would have been built out a little more on the interior than your average movie backdrop, but nonetheless, they could have certainly served that function. Interestingly enough, Universal Studios had discontinued the fabled tram tour by the time Disneyland opened in 1955, but it was Walt who convinced them to revive the attraction in the 1960s. Walt had no plans to build a working studio park or a backlot tour now that Disneyland had fulfilled all of his wildest dreams, so he firmly believed that Universal should provide this attraction once again in Southern California. Walt was so enamored with it all the times he had seen it. And, of course, that studio tour, one of the most famous attractions in all the world. And it was Walt who got that to come back. The glamour trams would have never been a thing if it hadn't been for Walt Disney.
It's kind of an amazing set of circumstances that you're interlinking Universal Parks and Disney Parks all the way from the very beginning, from the very inception of a theme park, really. The idea that Walt thought that Universal could handle a part of it, Disney would handle some of it and be different enough to be separate parks is interesting to me to think about where this could have gone and where we ended up now.
And well, Walt didn't believe in competition, I don't think, because wasn't he super friendly with Knott's Berry Farm, also in the Knott's family?
Absolutely, right.
Yeah. So they were all they all coexisted and did different things. And, it was a different time. People were not as cutthroat back then. But anyway, that's the early history. And then, of course, we come all the way to the 1980s. Michael Eisner comes into the Walt Disney Company. And, of course, we could spend time going into this development of the park, but we really won't waste that time because there's already a great Back to the Future you could listen to when we did the history of the Disney-Universal rivalry. Which started after Walt was friendly with them. Walt was gone, and then there was a rivalry. And that does a really good job of telling you about the development of the park. And we could spend hours just talking about the development of this from a single attraction at Epcot to a full-fledged theme park. But nonetheless, groundbreaking on the Backlot Tour began on March 27th, 1986. Back then, the entire park was called the Disney-MGM Studio Backlot Tour. It's referred to on several documents as that. And then I guess eventually they figured this is more than just a tour. Like, yeah, we have this half day tour thing, but we also have this animation thing and we have the great movie ride and there's the Indiana Jones show. So eventually they decided we're just going to call this the Disney MGM Studio. And of course, took a little over 3 years to complete, but the park did open on May 1st of 1989. There's some original concept art, which is very, very, there's a lot of it that's very similar. And then there's some, you're going to notice some areas that are quite different. So obviously Hollywood Boulevard and the Central Courtyard and then the production side, which will be on your right side there, pretty much turned out like that. But then the Backlot Tour actually did load from there. We're going to talk about that in a few moments. It did board on that right side, but there's a whole bunch of stuff going on in that backlot that did not happen. There's like a fake prop Matterhorn back there. You're actually seeing the backside of that, so you can see if you look real close, like all the pieces of wood holding up the facade. There's all sorts of different things going on. There looks like there's like a Western town all the way out there on the left side. There's a whole bunch of different things going on. So this is some earlier concept art. Before Star Tours was ever a thought and before the tour was fully fleshed out. But
if you look real close, you can still see the Golden Girls house in the back.
Where do you think the Golden Girls house is?
I'm just kidding.
Yeah, I was going to say. But there's a lot of more, I guess these wouldn't have been real movie sets. But I guess like these pretend movie sets, kind of like the Matterhorn. And then there's some sort of village north of the Great Movie Ride. There's a little village there. And there's a lot of weird little stuff like that. And
so yeah, we were supposed to get the vignettes like the studio tour in at Universal had at the time, like the earthquake, the Kong.
Yeah, so not actual working sets, but these like pretend sets. But then they were also going to have real production going on. So I don't know. I guess they were thinking all the real production would be in the sound stages for the most part, and then they'd use, you know, New York Street when they needed it, and maybe like that cowboy set. But I think a lot of that stuff back there was really just for play. I don't think the thought process was really, well, these are going to actually get used. And maybe, I mean, occasionally they would have, but yeah. But that was the original vision. So the park opened on May 1st, 1989. The Backlot Tour, then called the Backlot Studio Tour, opened up, loading guests where the magic of Disney animation, the script says, is currently, using an old script, where the magic of Disney animation, or where you walk in now for Star Wars Launch Bay, is where you loaded into the studio tram tour. So if that queue for the Launch Bay Theater ever seems a little big for what it is, that's why. That was the whole cue for the studio backlot tour. I see we've zoomed in. Yeah, you see, like, that's the back of the Matterhorn. And then there's, like, some big waterfront thing going on. I don't really know what's going on there. Maybe that would have been similar to the pre-show for backlot tour, the Pearl Harbor thing, something along those lines. That's much later what we're looking at. Let's get that out of here. We don't need to see that. No, you're going too far. Take the images down. We're going too far ahead.
Go back to the zoom in.
Go back to the zoom in.
No, I mean, one of the things that I appreciate about the artist concept of the park here is the idea that you have different sections of the park that are dedicated to genres of film. And I think that's something that I would have really loved to have seen in the current park, and we don't really get that. I mean, New York Street was one thing, but just as you look at it, you have your Western Town, you have your water areas where you could do, you know, pirate or adventure stories. There's even looks like an airplane and a mini airport. Mm-hmm. So the fact that you could wander through these immersive sets, I guess, if you will, or backlot areas and see the different genres is really intriguing.
Yeah. And then I think money got in the way, and I think they started thinking about things they could actually use for production. And I think early on, there was a lot of interest in because they had the Disney Channel. So there was so much stuff that they were going to produce that they knew they could fill, you know, space with, and they knew they were going to need backdrops and stuff for that. So much more of the back of the park became real, became things they could that served a functionality for actual studio production. And I think that's why we lost so much of that fake stuff. And then the fake stuff, they decided, well, why don't we do that in the part guests can walk through? You know, we'll do star tours up there and stuff like that. And that's the direction the park kind of went in for a long time.
Well, at the time, they also had the idea, and they've been doing this since the 70s. Like, Walt Disney World was such a big area with so many different environments, particularly with, like, the Epcot countries. You could film things there. You don't need to fake another version of that when you could. You know, I think what was the Treasure of Matacumbe was the first film filmed on property in like the 70s.
Yeah.
And they used it for all the swamps.
Well, let's think of the very popular 80s, 90s television show, Thunder in Paradise, starring Hulk Hogan, which if they had to go to an exotic locale, they went to a country in Epcot. So they filmed primarily at the Disney-MGM studios. But then if they, like you said, if they needed that exotic locale, they were using different areas of the resort, the Polynesian and the Grand Floridian and the Epcot World Showcase countries and things like that. So,
and the Living Seas.
Yeah. So they were doing things. They were using all of property to film. And that was one of the things I have it in the other room. I should have brought it in. There's like a 5-minute VHS tape that they sent to production companies, which attempted to convince them to come film at the Disney MGM studios. And that 5-minute tape basically goes on and on about, well, you could film, you know, we have stages and we have all these backdrops and you could film in all these other places in the parks. And So they were really trying very hard to get people to decide not to do production in Los Angeles, which is really funny now that look at like Georgia. How many movies are filmed in Georgia now? So other places have succeeded to get business to move out of Los Angeles, but the Disney-MGM studios, for whatever reason, combined with also Universal, both in the same town, which certainly helps.
Well, that's all about the tax credits.
Yeah.
Well, it also is something where...
Hey, it's Scott Smith, everybody.
Hey, everybody. Sorry I'm late. In terms of movie making, it becomes cheaper to travel than to build. Because to build sets, you need artisans. You need people that, you know, you need to pay craftsmen. Whereas, like, you know, in addition to your crew, where as opposed to, like, going to Georgia, you just need to fly your camera crew and your actors out there.
Yeah. Handful studios there too, and it's because, and part of that is the local unions are cheaper than the LA equivalents for those kind of things. Yeah.
But everything you need is there. It's not like when they started filming in Georgia. Now, if you want to go film in Georgia, there are warehouses upon warehouses of props where you can rent stuff out and everything. Everything you need, the same as in LA, is in Georgia. So,
well, and the magic of movie making is kind of, you know, worn off. I mean, like before, you know, people would be, you know, be impressed by the wizardry, and I don't know if I'm off topic here, if this was already discussed, but that's one of the
things that we have barely begun. We are just at the opening of the studio.
I do have work tomorrow, you know. but the wizardry of making movies, like, you don't need to fool people anymore, so you might as well just go to the real, like,
yeah,
with the advent of like DVD extras and stuff like that, people.
And these working studio theme parks, which were, you know, not even an exclusive concept to Disney and Universal, you know,
which I guess
the 90s.
That was the start of it, yeah.
Yeah, because you had, like, the Paramount parks that had some sort of behind-the-scenes-y stuff.
Yeah.
You know, it was a fad for a while. And then we left that fad, and now we were in this fad of, you know, fully immersive, single IP-themed environments. You know? Times change. But anyway, as I said, the magic of Disney Animation was, which is now Star Wars Launch Bay, that big queue was used to queue people up, and that's where you would load the trams. That's where you get on the tram, and that's where your journey would begin. And of course, Studio Tour was a premier attraction for the studios, one of the two headliners, that and the Great Movie Ride, especially considering the premise of the park was not only to entertain guests with attractions, but also immerse guests in the art and magic of real Hollywood production. This was a strange extension of Epcot, because again, the great moments at the movies pavilion was an idea for Epcot. So there was this whole idea of, again, edutainment, like we're going to show you. Not only are we going to entertain you, we're going to show you how the entertainment you consume is created. And so basically you have a park that's kind of founded on Epcot principles, but solely focusing on, you know, consumable entertainment, which I think is a really interesting concept. And I think that's why the park was so successful right out of the gate. I think it you know, sometimes there were themes in Epcot that didn't connect to people, but man, who doesn't like being entertained? I mean, it's a hard thing not to be intrigued about. There was kind of something for everybody here. The original tour was comprised of a number of segments. A tram tour was an integral part of the ride, which Disney Imagineers purposely put into the park to recreate the backlot tram tours you'd find in real Hollywood studios. You step through the gate of the Disney MGM studios and enter a working movie and television production center, and your stay would include an in-depth look at live-action movies and television, and a unique opportunity to visit Disney animators working on their newest featurettes. I'm going to now read you. This is the actual backlot tour itinerary that they gave out to guests that was listed in the maps and such. On the backstage studio tour, a two-part adventure, you go behind the scenes of a real motion picture studio. Please note, this two-hour guided tour involves an hour of walking. Restroom facilities are available at the shuttle station before you embark on your journey and at the start of your walking tour. Number one, the backstage shuttle station is where your adventure begins. You'll be introduced to the business of show business. Then you'll board a backstage shuttle. They called them backstage shuttles, fun fact, and travel into the heart of a production center where highlights will include Stop number two, costuming, where skilled designers create the clothes worn by your favorite stars, or at least the ones who came to film things in Orlando. Number three, the scenic shop. If it's in the script, here's where the studio craftsman will build it, and someday maybe even stuff for new Fantasyland will all be built back here. Number four, residential street. Look closely at the quote-unquote houses on this outdoor set. You may recognize the homes of famous movie and TV families. Number five, the Catastrophe Canyon, a perilous journey through a unique outdoor set. You'll experience amazing artificial disasters that seem real enough in the movies, but even more impressive up close. Number six, New York Street, a giant backlot set used to film busy street scenes. Forced perspective buildings at the end of the street make these two blocks look like an entire cityscape. Number seven, the water effects tank. You may be the star of a dramatic ocean storm scene. Number eight, the special effects workshop and shooting stage. Explore the fascinating science of optical and mechanical effects. This is before CGI, ladies and gentlemen, so they had to show you all the wizardry that they were doing back then, which wasn't computer animated. Number nine, the sound stages, specially designed stages that let you look in on movies and television shows in production. Please note the use of cameras or recording devices of any kind is prohibited inside sound stages. This is, of course, where the earliest of bloggers tried to take out their giant cameras and film anyway. It was really challenging when your camera was the size of half your body. Anyway, I'll keep going.
Good to see you real late.
Really missed you, Scott. Number 10, post-production editing and audio. What's post-production? I have no idea. When principal photography is complete, the films come here where editors, sound engineers, and other technicians add the finishing touches. And then number 11, the Walt Disney Theater, the final stop in your adventure where you'll see special sneak previews of new movies. Or in some cases, upcoming television shows, things of the sort that were in production at the time. There was also restaurants along the tour that were listed as part of the tour. There was the Soundstage Restaurant, where dining is big business. That was the movie from which they had sets in that restaurant until later years when it became Aladdin and Beauty and the Beast, quote unquote, sets. Those are animated, so they don't actually have sets. But that was counter service dining, which offered pizza, pasta, sandwiches, soups, and salads. You also had the catwalk bar, which back then did not require a $33,000 buy-in and $15,000 a year for you to not be allowed to take pictures inside of it, where beer, wine, cocktails, and specialty drinks are served. That was upstairs at the Soundstage Restaurant. So the Soundstage Restaurant is in the space that is now Disney Junior Live on Stage. That was a restaurant down there. And then the catwalk, the actual catwalk above that show facility and then the Soundstage Restaurant was the catwalk bar, which has now been enclosed and made Club 33, location for studios, one of four. And then, of course, there was the Studio Catering Company, which was you could visit on the halfway mark in your tour. So after the tram portion of the tour, you would then could take a break, go use the restrooms, go shop and then eat at the Studio Catering Company if you wanted to, which offered refreshing fruit salads, ice cream snack items, and beverages. So it wasn't really a full-fledged counter service back then, more of a snack stop. And then there were also a couple shops which you could visit, the Disney Studio Store, which is still there, one of the few things that's still standing. That's next to Little Mermaid, between Little Mermaid and Launch Bay. And that sold Walt Disney Studios and Touchstone Pictures clothing and accessories. There was also the Looney Bin, which was the shop across from the Studio Catering Company, which offered unique gag gifts, plush toys, and Looney souvenirs. And then as well on the studio tour, there were zany photo opportunities with your favorite cartoon stars. So that was everything you would see on this two-hour tour, which included basically a break in the middle where you could go eat and stuff in that backstage area before going on to the walking portion of the tour.
It's so weird to me that, like, a that a theme park would do something where, like, it's like one long thing.
It existed already. I mean, Universal had been doing it forever, and their tour was always very long.
I know, but I've never even to go on like the ride and then to stop and get off and then to. It reminds me of that. Was that a College Humor video with Patrick Warburton?
Oh, where they do the fake roller coaster,
and
it's like an hour long or something.
Yeah, it stops in the middle for a box lunch. That's what
I mean. I mean, but it's the same as Epcot. Disney was not just looking to build more theme parks back then. That happened more when Animal Kingdom came about. Then they were just looking to add more parks to the resort. So they added like Animal Kingdom and Disney Sea and Walt Disney Studios Paris and DCA are just parks to add more rides. They didn't really necessarily, I guess Animal Kingdom kind of, but they didn't really have like a driving purpose behind them to be something completely different. Disney-MGM Studios wasn't really meant to be a theme park. Was it a theme park in name? Absolutely. But the idea was it was sort of this half-day like boutique park thing where you would come in and you could do this backlot tour experience. But then there was a couple of rides and restaurants and stuff and a lot of shows, all these different behind-the-scenes things. So it philosophically, again, similar to Epcot in that they were like, well, this isn't just a theme park. Epcot is, as Danny Kaye sings the song in the opening special of Epcot, that it's everything and more, and he lists all the other things that Epcot is. It's the same thing with the studios. It had a completely different purpose. It wasn't just like, hey, a Guardians of the Galaxy roller coaster, hey, a Frozen boat ride. And, it was you're not going to a theme park today. Today you're going to learn how movies and television are made.
Yeah, it almost is like a compliment to kind of like how the Hershey, like, again, I know Tom's would be like, oh, stop bringing up inferior things, but like how the inferior or the Hershey thing is like the chocolate tour, but that's like a separate ride from the theme park.
It almost, but then they also have a water park, right? I mean,
I don't know. I wasn't.
I don't know if they do, but I mean, there's that model where the Six Flags and stuff like that then also have a water park, which is something that complements what already exists. It's not building, which is like, think about a common complaint now people have, especially since the last D23 Expo. A lot of people are like, well, if you just keep building like thrill rides and stuff in each of these parks and bulldoze what they were, then they all just kind of become Magic Kingdom eventually.
Yeah.
And that's absolutely true. They each park should have a purpose. Like, you have an existing park, keep adding to that, but do all the parks just have to be like themed lands based on IP, or can you transcend that and actually give other parks a different purpose? And I think that's a thing we've lost. I think different parks should have different purposes. I mean, why do the same thing over and over? I mean, I think that's what
is cool. Money.
Yeah, and I think that's what's cool. Like, they all do still have a personality. But it's a good question 20, 30 years from now, how much different personality will the four parks in Florida actually have? I think Animal Kingdom, because it's so well-defined, will keep a personality. But will the other three just kind of become like, will Epcot just become Big Tomorrowland? Like, I don't, I think it's important that they all kind of have an identity. I'm not saying you have to stick with something that didn't necessarily work, but they all should have some sort of identity that makes them different. Anyway, back to the tour. Ron, did you have a point you wanted to make?
No, I just said because money.
The tour would begin with a stop at the production center, which included costuming, where guests could peer into the costuming shop and observe cast members creating costumes for various Hollywood productions. In later years, this would just become costuming for Walt Disney World, basically. All these things had to change as time went on and production actually stopped at the park. They had to find new uses. But surprisingly, the largest tourist destination in the world found uses for all of these things along the backlot tour, which gave it a continued life. There you're seeing the costuming. In later years, that's when it was just, costuming for the parks and such at Walt Disney World. You'll even see, I think you see like a Donald costume. This was followed by the Scenic Shop, where craftsmen constructed sets for use in production. And the tram tour also included a trip to what was called Residential Street, which was a street with home facades from famous television shows. These houses were used for wide shots of the home of the characters in the TV show and were actually nothing more than a front with no sides or an interior constructed. There you see Residential Street. So this is, if you're young, you're going to have no idea what we're talking about. But sitcoms and such in the 80s and 90s, generally, like, to give you the idea of where things were taking place, they'd always start a scene, like, with the exterior.
An establishing shot.
An establishing shot, exactly. So on Golden Girls, which the Golden Girls house, the most famous one that was displayed at the Disney-MGM studios, they would open the show, or whenever they came back to the house, they'd have this establishing shot of the outside of the house, which was just this facade that was sitting at the Disney-MGM studio. And that continued on for many years. Like Seinfeld, they showed like the outside of the apartment or the outside of whatever restaurant they were going to have the next scene in. They don't really do that anymore. It's not really, I don't think, at least in any sitcom I've seen in recent years, it doesn't really exist anymore. But
they don't have the time with the added commercials and things. They just,
they film most things in like real houses now too, don't they? Like
they do it in some. There's
like Modern Family is like filmed in like
yeah. I was gonna say they don't need to have the exterior shot because like you're not trying to sell the illusion of a set.
Everything's shot in that mockumentary style, so everything's shot in.
And like I said, it's also easier to travel. Like for when I was an actor a couple of years ago, for the few little things I did, it was easier to just throw someone like $100 to use their house for a couple hours.
Yeah.
Then build a set that, like, yeah, you have to contend with elements and sounds from, like, the street and crap like that, but it's cheaper in the long run. So, and if you're in an actual house or whatever, you don't have to sell. Yeah, like, you don't have to sell it like you did where Family Matters had the house before after every commercial break and they pan in and that kind of thing.
Yeah, and Scott makes a great point, and I want to circle back to this when we get later as we're talking about the park, but the fact that production technology has made the equipment so much more mobile speaks directly to Scott's point, that it is easier now, whereas previously, in order to bring the lighting and the sound and the video or film equipment in, you know, you needed tons and tons of U-Hauls. Now, you know, you're basically filming stuff on something that's almost the size of the old mini camcorders. So you can travel a lot more. So you don't need these sets as they're not as prevalent as they used to be.
Well, it's also the difference between single camera and multi-camera productions. Multi-camera, you're still going to always use a soundstage because you do need that space to be able to move things around like that.
Extra control, yeah.
So yeah, these houses were used for wide shots of the homes. And the houses displayed include the Golden Girls house, we already mentioned, Empty Nest, look it up, kids, Adventures in Wonderland, look it up, kids, and Ernest Saves Christmas, which I expect all of you have seen.
This was in trouble because even like I remember this very clearly as a kid, but I had no idea what the houses were. Like even as someone who was alive to see it, I didn't know everything. So this
Empty Nest. By the time I was a kid, I didn't even know what Empty Nest was. I had no idea what that was. Some of those were still on at the time. Like, obviously, I was very aware of Adventures in Wonderland. But Ernest Saves Christmas wasn't exactly a classic. It didn't remain relevant. So. And
didn't they move, like, the Rocketeer, like... the
Bulldog Cafe.
Yeah.
Yeah, Bulldog Cafe was there, too. And again, things switched out, which was the great thing about this park, I think, was how often exhibits and things change. So the idea was every time you'd come back and visit, there'd be different stuff. And generally, like, a lot of the houses obviously stayed. But, like, stuff in the Boneyard, vehicles and other things were always changing. There's always
like the Miley Cyrus egg coop or whatever.
And that was even in later years. Like, that's, like, you're talking, like, 2009. Like, things were still rolling in. The studios were still, like, trying to send stuff down here, which was great. You know, it kept the ride alive.
I guess.
Well, I mean, as much as you could. I mean, they didn't just give up on the Backlot Tour. I don't think at any point they ever gave up on it.
I don't know.
There was always stuff coming in.
When did it get marked? like, I don't know, after Cars Land, like, and the rumor
that was around the time, like 2012, everyone was like, all right, something's coming with studios. It's something big's going to happen.
Yeah. I think I remember like the strong rumor being that we were going to get Radiator Springs Racer.
Yeah. And I mean, in it was definitely slotted. I mean, I've seen concept art and stuff of it. But then I think there was a number of reasons why. We'll talk about that later. Later, we're going to talk about the closure and everything. So we'll get there.
I might be asleep by that time.
During the first few years of Residential Street, Herbie the Love Bug greeted guests as they passed by on the tram tour and would squirt water and open his doors.
That I actually remember very well.
Yeah. Following Residential Street, the tram would proceed and take a tour of New York Street. During that time, New York Street was closed to guests and was used only for the Backlot tour and real production work. Included in the area was some of the facades we would see in the past, including what the couple that still exist on Grand Avenue now. And as well, back then, there was a reproduction of Washington Square Park Memorial at the beginning of the street way back in the day. New York Street's greatest claim to fame was that it was used in the Bette Midler film The Lottery. Following the tram tour through New York Street, the tram would come into Catastrophe Canyon, a movie set that demonstrated the use of special effects to make us believe that a film was being, that they were doing this shoot where an oil tanker would blow up and a flood of water would come down. And yes, this was a blatant ripoff of Earthquake. I don't think anyone would argue that. There were a lot of things that both parks ripped each other off with.
And now it's all CGI.
This was the most blatant ripoff of Universal in this park. It was absolutely Catastrophe Canyon. It was not an original thing. And even in Earthquake, an oil tanker literally slides towards your vehicle. Like, they didn't even try to be original.
Yeah.
Here. Yeah. Catastrophe Canyon, of course, no longer standing, but it was one of the longest standing parts of the park, of course, and really for many people, the highlight of the Studio Backlot tour. Of course, many years later when the entrance moved, the big billboard, I know we have this image, the big billboard up on top of the attraction, the marquee, actually would say featuring Catastrophe Canyon, and there was even a sign down at the bottom that showed like New York Street and Catastrophe Canyon. It was one of the highlighted things you were going to see. It was one of the highlights, supposed to be one of the highlights of the tour.
I hated it, personally.
I didn't think it was the greatest thing ever. I didn't mind it. It wasn't my favorite part of the tour. Like, I know it was a lot of people's favorite part.
It was a lot of horrible stuff happening. Like, and as a kid, I guess I didn't really get, like, oh, this is a movie, and I'm just like, fire. water.
Yeah.
But now, like, especially now it's all CGI. Like, now they would never spend that money on oil and water.
That was the movie magic of the time. That's why movie production was such a fascinating thing to people, because it was so complicated. And so much of it was unbelievable how complicated it was in what you saw. And then what you didn't see, the behind the scenes, was like, oh, it's just a set. It's all, you know, hollow in the back.
I mean, not to go all kids these days, but Catastrophe Canyon.
But kids these days.
But Catastrophe Canyon, by today's movie standards, was actually fairly slow moving, and it feels, you know, it's unrealistic to kids now. I mean, when my kids went on it, they were almost unimpressed because it looked fake from the moment they came in. You had to kind of use more imagination to understand it. So. I think that's why it may not be as popular with the younger generation of theme park goers that we're seeing it.
And nowadays, someone would sue them for putting them in danger because they would pretend that they didn't know it was all fake setup and thought they actually got driven onto a real set that was going to hurt them.
I think that's a stretch. I mean,
they make it a super stretch.
I mean, they literally go around back and see the like as a. I mean, I guess people have sued over stupider crap, but
I mean, trust me, totally, they have.
It's totally possible, though. I don't put it past anybody. Oh boy, yeah, yeah. But I mean, the part I couldn't believe is just like, as a kid, I always realized the similarities to Earthquake, but I, you know, later on, knowing everything you learn later on, it's unbelievable. Just like Disney was just like, yeah, let's just do a tanker like them. Just copy it. We just won't put it. We're not going to be down in the subway. That's going to be the difference. We're going to be out in, like, the desert. No subway this time.
Yeah, they were. This was a vicious time. Like, I wonder if they, like, this is getting completely off topic to the Backlot tour, but I wonder if things would have started a little more amiable, then we wouldn't have this divide we have now.
Well, remember we talked about how Universal at one point was the other half of this park equation for a short period. I mean, that's in our Back to the Future where we talk about the history of the rivalry. But there was a period where, you know, Disney was suddenly also building a studio and Universal was like, well, we're not going to build a competing one. Why don't we just work with them? And then eventually Disney was like, nah. And that was kind of the start of the rivalry. I don't know what that noise was. Move on.
I'm playing Stardew Valley.
Oh, great.
I'm playing Rapt Attention.
Fantastic. Along the way, continuing on the Backlot tour, was the Boneyard, an area not the playground at Animal Kingdom, an area along either side of the tram's path where random props from Disney films were displayed for guests to view. The Boneyard was placed there because in real Hollywood, Backlot studios would keep old props around in case they were needed for future production. At the Disney-MGM Studios, the Boneyard served more as a museum of relics of past films, including props from The Rocketeer, Who Framed Roger Rabbit, Star Wars, among others. I want you to think of this time. This is a time where nobody saw a true value in any of these items. It was decided that we'll just leave them all outside to rot, and maybe some old guy will ride his bike past them.
How many of these have you sold, Tom?
We had the Flight of the Navigator ship. We absolutely saw
it. Oh, man. If I had a point for that.
Oh, yeah, that happened. I forget what else we had from back. Nothing else big, but think about this. Like, props from Star Wars. Like, now Star Wars props have such value to them now.
I remember around this time, it was probably 93. It was the first, like, Star Wars, Star Trek convention I went to. I could have bought a screen-used Stormtrooper rifle for $125, which was a lot of money for a middle schooler, and I didn't have it, but now I probably could have paid off my student loans with that thing.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a different time. And then even you hear stories about Universal, the stuff they left out on the tour, like they left out the DeLorean. That was the original DeLorean, and then years later it had to be, thankfully it was renovated, but then also you hear other stories like, what they did to the Orca from Jaws, the ship, where it was destroyed. The Orca, one of the most legendary vehicles in film history, completely destroyed on the Backlot. And then let's not mention all the things that have burnt down in Universal's Backlot over the years. So it's a shame. I think back then they're just, I don't know if there was that same.
Well, certainly not. I mean, to them, it's a business. Like, yeah. not to steal that refrain from like other people, but it's a business to them. To the people filming Jaws, they were probably so sick of the Orca, they probably would have like burned it themselves. And like, so like, they don't give a crap. Like I said, they're like, oh, I'll burn it myself. I don't care. I've seen this thing enough. But yet, to the people who watch the movies, it's more like, oh, wait a minute, you know. So to them, it doesn't mean as much.
Yeah.
In fact, they're probably only keeping it so they could use it as another boat and another water thing.
And now are they going to leave out our parades?
Yeah, then that happened to Spectrum Magic many years later. Oh, boy. Scott, can you mute whatever that game is? Very loud. Thank you. Following that, you would then disembark from the tram and exit where the studio catering company used to be located. It's now like, I think this is Woody's Lunchbox area now. This would mark the halfway point of the tour and allow guests a quick break before continuing. In subsequent years, the break was expanded to include the Honey, I Shrunk the Kids movie set adventure as an area for kids to play. Then it would begin the walking portion of the backlot tour, where guests would watch a water tank demonstration of how special effects are used to make convincing film, convincing filming of what looks like ship-based films. The water tank demonstration would feature a number of guests volunteering to be a part of the demonstration and acting out roles as sailors on board the ship. Following the water tank demonstration was a walking tour of the sound stages at the studios that were along Mickey Avenue via elevated overhead walkways. So now these are all officially gone. The final one of these was blown out when they created this new pathway. What you're looking at there is in later years when it was the Pearl Harbor pre-show. But yeah, that used to start your walking tour portion. So you'd start with that presentation in the tank area. And then you'd go up through these elevated walkways and go above each sound stage to see what was under production at the time. And you would have seen, these were very easy to see. So between Toy Story Mania and One Man's Dream was one of them. There was another one back on the other side of Pixar Place, connected to the sound stage, which was next to the backlot tour entrance. And these would have connected between the sound stage. And then when you were in the actual sound stage, you would have looked through glass, soundproof glass, down to see where the actual production was taking place. Which was a really novel concept. I remember vividly as a kid watching them film the Mickey Mouse Club, a new Mickey Mouse Club. I want to clarify, yes, there was a version well after the 50s that I was alive for. And stuff like that. I don't remember what else. I think game shows. I don't know what game show I remember seeing. But they were always doing stuff in those sound stages, at least back when I was a kid. And then, of course, as time went on, less and less and less.
There was a sitcom set. I don't remember what it was.
I don't know which one.
Yeah.
There's a long list of things that were filmed there.
But did we mention the Bee and the Bette Midler movie that were the beginning of this section?
That's the next thing we're going to.
Okay. I thought that was before the sound stages.
Yeah, it definitely was. I don't know why it's in a different order here. But nonetheless, yeah, so you'd leave. What? I don't know. It's in a different order here. You would leave the tank and go into what was titled Inside the Magic Special Effects and Production Tour, where special effects were demonstrated for guests. At one point, there was a giant bumblebee from Honey, I Shrunk the Kids that was used in front of a green screen to demonstrate how green screens work. And now, kids, Jason Diffendahl just sits in his room with the green screen and does shows. So, I mean, look how far we've come, that that technology now exists in poorly produced YouTube programming. So we've come a long way. So you'd like sit, kids, two guests were chosen from the group to ride the bee as if it was flying around the backyard. And this is how they created that scene in the original Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, where the kids are, of course, shrunken down to this size and ride on the back of a bee. And they would basically put you in this situation. And then you'd go through the stages where you were offered a chance to peer into the sound stages. Productions included the Mickey Mouse Clubhouse and other Disney Channel shows. You also had Jim Henson's Creature Shop, which still had a sign up until the time the backlot tour was closed. Near the end of the walking tour was a making of set tour of the latest Disney film. And this attraction would then empty out into the Walt Disney Theater. The tour then ended with a short film called Michael and Mickey, where Michael Eisner and Mickey Mouse introduced the previews of current and upcoming films. And following this making of area, guests would leave the attraction and walk through a store or towards a store called the Disney Studio Store, where guests could buy Disney and Touchstone Pictures clothing and accessories. So I want you to think about it this way. That entire, do we have the park map again? I'd like to show people the park map. There's a reason everything was laid out the way it was laid out on that side of the park. I don't know if that's enough of it. I was thinking that older one. I think that older one shows a little more. The one with just the colorful buildings. That's not quite enough. There we go. This is going to give you a really good idea of how this all worked. And they're all numbered in order. So you see down in the right, number one is where your shuttle tour started. And you can see the path continuing to two and three and four. We have five, which is Catastrophe Canyon, then six. And then the order of all this changed several times, which is why we may have talked about it out of order. But this at least will give you an idea to, in 1989 what the order was. Because eventually things got lopped off very quickly. Things like that. Things got added. Yes, you see, we went through New York Street. And then you had the break, which is the green and blue buildings in the middle. You have the loony bin and back the catering company and all that stuff. And then number seven is where you began the walking tour. Number seven is the tank. Yeah, seven. So then you would leave the tank and you go through a path and you go into eight, which was inside the magic where you would see where you get to ride the bee and they show you how they do that with a green screen. And then you'd walk across an elevated walkway into nine, which were the sound stages that you could actually go through and look down. And it's two sound stages there. Of course, both of those now are Toy Story Midway Mania, which is kind of fascinating that they've blown out the whole rest of this back lot now. But Toy Story Mania will always be these production buildings and will probably be there for a very, very long time. And then you'd continue it through another overhead walkway into 10, which was the, you know, making of or what they call it here. Yeah, making of. And this changed even well after the tour was separated and broken down and everything. This was always the making of. So this was never a production facility. This was kind of just going like through a prop warehouse, basically. And you would go through whatever movie. And again, it changed all the time. Just a bunch of props from a certain movie, which then went into 11. The theater building where you would sit in the theater and watch that Michael and Mickey short, which was followed by what they called the dailies, things being produced at the Disney-MGM studios, which someone running a studio would watch dailies of like what's produced by the studio that day. So again, you're being taken behind the scenes. You're getting to see something. Maybe you feel like you're not supposed to see a very special experience. And it would end in that 11, which eventually would become Voyage of the Little Mermaid down the road. But yeah. But you see, they even lumped in a soundstage restaurant and catwalk bar got lumped in just because they were in the courtyard where you boarded the studio backlot tour. But another thing you have to realize, everything you're seeing in that back area was not accessible by walking. You could walk around that little green and blue area, backstage plaza, but the rest of all that, you had to either be in the tram or you were on a guided walking tour. Otherwise, the front of the park was the only part of the entire park you could walk around. But that would change very, very quickly, and we'll start talking about that now. This is probably a good image to keep up as we talk about this thing getting hacked to death. The first round of changes to the Backlot Tour came early in the history of the studios due to the necessity of needing more attractions for guests in the park. The park was really popular early on, so much so that it would close at capacity on a fairly regular basis. The park was a huge success right off the bat. In addition, the original tour was quite long, again, an hour and a half, and then also with the break. Disney wanted to break up some of the attraction to make things easier on the park guest. Maybe so they could do things a little more a la carte. Within just a few months of opening, the Walt Disney Theater, where guests emptied out, was separated and became its own theater, which went on to show Here Comes the Muppets, and later in 1992, Voyage of the Little Mermaid, which unbelievably is still running. Also, by the end of 1989, New York Street was removed from the tour and opened up to guests to help alleviate congestion in the park. And the tram portion of the tour was altered so the tram would bypass New York Street and go from Residential Street straight to Catastrophe Canyon. So you may remember in later years with Osborne Lights and everything, the tram would do this tour, this turn down at the end of New York Street. That came about very, very early in the history of the park. To further cut down on the time needed for the entire attraction, the tour was split into two in 1991. The tram portion of the tour became the 30-minute backlot tour, while the walking portion of the tour was renamed Backstage Pass. Because this was cut down, there was really no reason to load the tram where it had loaded originally. So they decided to move it further into the park where it was before it closed at the end of Mickey Avenue, with a new entrance ramp built to lead right into the water effects tank, as well as a prop warehouse built to create a longer queue area, as well as a loading area for the trams. Along with the walking portion being removed from the tour, a smaller theater was constructed as an exit for Backstage Pass. So that new theater that was the exit for Backstage Pass eventually became the Walt Disney Theater, where One Man's Dream plays. That's why there's this strange other theater that exists over there now. So you may have been wondering, when Voyage took the other theater, what happened? Well, there you see. And it's always been the Walt Disney Theater, fun fact. So it's only fitting that later on it went to host One Man's Dream. Look at that. Star Search is even labeled. Star Search filmed for quite a while in Soundstage 3. So it even had a little thing on the map. The tour was split in half. And they did a walking tour and the Backlot tour. But the Backlot tour took on some of the walking tour in that the tank became like this pre-show thing. And here you see, this gives you a good idea of it. And obviously New York Street very quickly was marked for expansion. They threw Muppet Vision 3D in there, and Honey, I Shrunk the Kids was there. So there was a reason to connect all this and make it guest area. They added Sci-Fi Dine-In. Star Tours came on board real quick in 89. But
Ninja Turtles.
Yeah, yeah, Ninja Turtles were back there. They always did a whole bunch of shows and stuff. Obviously, there was a theater built after this. There was a Backlot theater in years later.
And meet and greets with the Muppets as well.
Yeah. So there was a lot of stuff going on these streets back here. And so they kept that one piece of the walking tour went to Backlot tour. They had that new prop warehouse in the queue, which over the years would change many, many times to always updating to current props. Like towards the end, there was even stuff from like Prince of Persia and Surrogates and much more contemporary movies. So they were always, and as Scott brought up, the chicken coop from Hannah Montana. All that stuff kept rolling in over the years.
Leave it to me to bring up Miley Cyrus.
Good for you. Good job. Meanwhile, the Backstage Pass attraction, the walking tour, would continue to operate until 2001 when budget cuts hit the parks, in part due to the tourism industry slump. The Backstage Pass attraction closed and began being cannibalized for other needs. The small theater area where the Backstage Pass guests exited was changed and became Walt Disney One Man's Dream. In April of 2001, Soundstage 3 was opened to the public in the form of Who Wants to Be a Millionaire? Play It. And Backstage Pass would continue to run, even though two of these major components were ripped off of it. It still somehow continued to sporadically function until February of 2002. And then finally they were like, no, we don't need this anymore. Let's get rid of this. But already then they were starting to look at, well, what do we do with these different pieces of space? This is what they did. They broke off Millionaire. Millionaire made use of one of the soundstages because, again, they weren't booking a whole lot of production for the park. So they kind of just needed to fill with attractions and things. And so they started doing a lot of pseudo, working studio type attractions, which were convincing enough that they were real production, but were really just for the enjoyment of guests. And one of those things was Millionaire. The building at the end continued to host Soundstage 12, I think it is, continued to host the making of or behind the scenes attractions in later years, hosted the Haunted Mansion and props from other movies, Narnia, the Narnia attractions, which were really, really awful. And then, of course, who could forget the legend of Captain Jack Sparrow? What a great offering.
We want to forget it.
Yeah. Now just a walkway. An attraction so great, it was replaced with a walkway. What is it with things with Captain Jack?
By the way,
Captain Jack's at Downtown Disney got blown out for a walkway, and the legend of Captain Jack Sparrow got blown out for a walkway. Anyway,
the people know what they want.
They do walkways. Not want any form of Captain Jack. They decided. But so yeah, that was the end of the walking tour. But of course, the studio tram tour continued to function.
But going back to that, I mean, Millionaire, when it had those shows, it at least gave the still illusion that they were doing stuff and they had the facilities that they could do something like Millionaire.
Well, it fit well. It was a real soundstage. They basically completely rebuilt the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire set, like down to the littlest details. It fit the park incredibly well. And even like American Idol did the same thing. American Idol Experience, very much along the same lines, whether you liked it or not, still fit this theme that they were hanging on to even into, you know, 2009.
Oh, yeah. It made great use of the old Superstar Television in the Hyperion Theater.
Yep. Which is empty now, for many years.
And now is the green screen effects of a poorly produced YouTube show.
Yeah. Jason, wherever he is. So, fun fact, even though in Florida they were in the process of cutting down and closing portions of the Backlot tour, now you're seeing, I don't know if we showed these before, but this is obviously where the tour moved the entrance to this facade down at the end of Mickey Avenue. And you'd walk under, what a great marquee on a metal gate, the attraction marquee, there it is. Changed a couple times with the crashed. Yeah. How exciting. Kids, you want to go on this ride that crashes? Yeah. That always did get out of place. Crashes and loses the rest of the train. just
yeah, but then it does. Like, imagine like going on thinking it will. And then it's like, oh,
it's like,
that was on a letdown.
Nothing even happened.
Yeah.
So, wow. While the Backlot tour is going over like gangbusters in Florida, they're building this Walt Disney Studios Paris park, and someone decides, hey, this great park should have its own Backlot tour.
Oh, boy. I'll go on my rant on this one later.
I don't know what you're showing. That is nothing pertaining to anything. I was
like, that doesn't look like it.
That's Burbank. That was the MGM Backlot they wanted to build in Burbank. That's not even a thing we're going to talk about this time. It's a close-up of a tram concept art. We're going to keep going. I don't know. That's something. Oh, this is fun. Let's show these. So go back to that model picture you just showed. Some things that were planned. Look at this. This may look familiar if you've ever been to Tokyo Disney Sea or seen videos of that. This is Journey to the Center of the Earth, and you're not seeing things. That is a Backlot tour tram model going through Journey to the Center of the Earth. This was a planned scene to be added to the Backlot tour at some point in the early 90s. So fun fact, even you could even see like a big squid tentacle on the other side. So I guess maybe a squid would have been a part of this too. But that's definitely the lava monster that would show up later in the Journey to the Center of the Earth attraction at Disney Sea, which again shows you a good idea. Never goes away at Walt Disney Imagineering. That other model picture you had of those ruins was also in here. There you see like a lava effect. You would have driven through some lava. There's some more of the model. And one thing you realize, Tokyo Disney Sea, the Imagineers that worked on that, I guess that's just part of him. I guess that was more of his body. One of the things that happened with that park that's kind of fun is because the Imagineers were kind of given a really big budget and not a whole lot of restrictions, they ended up building a lot of things that were canceled for other parks throughout the 90s. So Journey to the Center of the Earth being one of those things ended up in Disney Sea. And actually, if you go back to one of those concept art pictures of the Backlot for Burbank, you go back to those. It might be the Texas one too. No, not that. Keep going. Keep going. Nope, we're frozen. There's one. No, keep the Burbank concept art. Keep going.
No, no, no.
This is going to be riveting on the podcast version.
Nope. That's the beginning.
You're not changing images. We're just looking at the lava monster.
No, it's changing.
I think is it? It's stuck for me, maybe.
Yeah, you had it. It's the one before the street diagram, Michael.
Before the street diagram?
Yeah, not this one. The one right before.
That one?
No, go the other direction. There you go. Right there. I think. No, that's not it at all.
I can't see anything, so I don't know what to tell you. I just lost visual now.
I got to remember the delay.
No, I'm not even seeing like an image, so we're I don't even know what to do at this point. So great. I'll just keep moving on then. Never mind my very cool point I was going to make, because I don't know what's being shown anymore.
But it was a doozy, I can tell you.
Well, in one of the versions of that MGM backlot thing they were going to do, there's actually like a big sailing ship, which looks just like the SS Columbia, which again, they built at Tokyo Disney Sea. So a lot of things throughout the 90s, including ideas for MGM, came back to life later when they did. Oh, I think I've got it back. Not this. Is it this one? No, there's another. There's another version of this art. Keep going through everything. We're going to find this. Oh, we're going to find it. No, nope, not that one. There's
we're
going to
find it. No,
there's one more. We're going to get there. Unless you didn't download all the images. We're going to find out.
May have been one of the recent ones.
Live on the air.
That's not it. Keep going.
Did he download all the images? Riveting.
You're like going back through the same stuff now. There's a costume you can
do. We have our
answer. Oh, the plane. We'll talk about the plane. We'll get there.
The plane that is literally still there.
Oh, I think you mean the ones near this one?
Well, it's good. We're getting to Paris. There we go. This is when they were going to do that concept in Texas. If you look in the back there, there's the Columbia sitting back there in the like a marina back there. But it's actually, again, like a static building of a ship. So, yeah, I hope that was worth it. But now you can all see what I was talking about. But that was the interesting thing is in the 90s, the Disney MGM studios, they liked this concept and it was doing so well straight out of the gate. That at first they were thinking about doing it as sort of this indoor-outdoor theme park complex in Texas. And then the other two pieces we showed you were for a plot in Burbank, which was actually the plot that Disneyland was going to go in originally. So they were thinking about these boutique park, studio park ideas in other places, but they never came to fruition. Instead, they went with Disney Quest. What a great decision. All right. Speaking of great decisions, we're going to go back to Paris now. Where they decided to open a studios park in 2002, and on March 16, 2002, it opened with the Studios Tram Tour at the park, which again was basically, over 10 years later, building the backlot tour again. Why they thought this was a good idea? Probably because it was cheap, and that was kind of the approach to this park in California Adventure at that point. The Walt Disney Company wasn't looking to spend a lot of money in these new parks. And the tram tour would have been a cheaper thing than a lot of other attractions. So guests enter this version via the quote-unquote Hollywood Boulevard. I use that very loosely, their Hollywood Boulevard. Under the false facade of a Hollywood sign and the tram ride portion of the attraction would feature highlights such as Catastrophe Canyon, which if you thought it was not very impressive in 1989, you should have seen it at the opening of a new park in 2002. You'd also look into the set of London in Ruins from the film Reign of Fire. Kids, look it up. And Imagineers wanted to create a studio tour at Walt Disney Studio Paris as they had at the Hollywood Studios, where the tour was once the park's signature attraction. However, in this case, they knew they really weren't going to have any real filming going on. So they did a lot of these, just props from existing productions like Dinotopia. They decided would be a thing that would
stay
in people's minds for a while. The ABC miniseries event that did not happen.
Oh, wait a second. I can bring up the Boneyard that we had from the last Back to the Future.
All right, but people have seen it.
I have pictures of these somewhere. If you want me to look for them, I can.
No, it's fine. We're not spending a lot of time on Paris. Also, this is going to be closing soon, and I'm going out at the end of the month, and I'm going to document this studio tour, and you can all enjoy it.
So I did it back in about 4 years ago now. And how they did the narration is they had, I think, English cars and French cars. And it was, I believe it was supposed to be Jeremy Irons doing a video narration.
It absolutely. The voiceovers were done mainly by Jeremy Irons, yeah.
But they weren't working on any of the trams when I was there.
That sounds about right.
You're stopping by these scenes.
By the way, we're not looking at Fast and Furious at Universal. This is the backlot tour at Paris.
So you stop by this one scene, and it looks like some sort of like Indiana Jones backdrop, like a temple or something. And they still stop there, even though there's no narration, nobody telling you what you're looking at. You're just stopped for about 3 minutes staring at this wall. And then you just move on to the exact catastrophe can. And then you get here. There's no explanation on what this is. And I don't think anybody knew it was from Rain of Fire. I just
happened to nobody guess. Knew what Rain of Fire was.
Yeah, either. To date. That's another big problem with this. Disney was hampered because when they... I guess early in MGM it was okay, but they really didn't have a string of crazy successes.
They started to become irrelevant again towards the end of the Eisner years, yeah. Animated and live action, they were struggling. And that was the problem, is when the Disney MGM studios opened, they were having like hit after hit. And even like the mediocre stuff was still like connecting with some people. Like Rocketeer wasn't some giant smash hit, but enough people like knew what it was and or liked it that it was cool to have Rocketeer stuff around. And other things were hitting, like Splash and Dick Tracy, and all that stuff was Roger Rabbit. They were on such a roll. Yeah. Live action, then not to mention animation, happened to hit big just as they were opening this park. You know, Little Mermaid opened just around the same time. So the Renaissance, everything came together at the right time for this park. Disney's studio actually started to become, the giant hit studio it is today at that point in time. So it was all the right things happening at the right time. Meanwhile, back in Florida, though, even though they've just spent all this time building a whole new Backlot tour in Paris, they're about to shorten the Backlot tour in Florida, thanks to something from Paris. On July 2nd, 2003, Residential Street was closed to the public and then demolished. A small cast member only event was held to mark the closing of Residential Street before it began its demolition. The area was being removed to make way for the Lights, Motors, Action Extreme Stunt Show. Thank God that's gone. A show that was being imported from Disneyland Paris as part of the Disney Parks worldwide 50th anniversary celebration, the happiest celebration on earth, where Walt Disney World was getting something from all the resorts around the world. Because of this addition of the stunt show, the tram tour had to be reworked quite a bit, and small portions of the old Residential Street returned to the areas for the Boneyard portion of the tour, which was dramatically scaled down. In addition to Residential Street being demolished, the archway on New York Street was also taken down to make room for the tram to be able to maneuver through the area. Aside from trying to cut down the total runtime of the attraction, there was the reality that hit that despite Disney's best efforts, real production was not coming back to the Disney MGM studios. Disney had tried to use the studios to lure Hollywood production to Florida as an alternative to Hollywood, where things would be cheaper. The Florida Film Commission even offered tax breaks and credits, but alas, more often than not, guests would take the tour and see empty sound stages. In addition, the walking portion of the tour was despised by filmmakers who did not like the public watching while production occurred. As much as Disney wanted the studios to become the East Coast equivalent of Hollywood, it was not going to happen. And Disney was forced to convert the sound stages for other uses. As we said, Millionaire, it was the Sorcerer Mickey meet and greet. And even, of course, Toy Story Mania in later years. And ultimately, the demise of the Backlot Tour went hand in hand with the reduction and subsequent removal of production at the studios. So this was sort of the beginning of the end. You lost this large portion of the tour. You lost Residential Street, and you had a much reduced Boneyard. But they decided that these were two parts of the tour that people weren't really going crazy about anyway, so they figured, Why don't we just lop them off? And for most people, this is when they say they lost interest in the attraction. I'm not sure that this was like the breaking point with the tour for me, but it certainly didn't help.
Wasn't it around that time where they started moving away from the cast members?
No, you still had a long time before that happened. They were not really related. This was just a shortening.
It's fairly late in its lifespan that they...
Yeah, so in 2008, that's a full 5 years after that. Imagineering announced to cast members that an automated narration spiel was in development to replace all the live tour guides on the shuttle portion of the tour. Of course, the special effects tank continued to have a live cast member due to the nature of volunteer guests. The entire attraction went down for 2 months of refurbishment in January of 2008. The attraction was also renamed the Studio Backlot Tour in preparation for the park's name change a few weeks later. This, you got to remember the park, but up till then it was the Disney-MGM Studios Backlot Tour, became the Studio Backlot Tour when the name change of the park happened in early 2008. But yeah, they were two unrelated things. It was just slowly over time. I think they were just tired of spending that much money on spieling cast members at the attraction. And so they decided it would just make more sense to do a, you know, singular recorded spiel. Although I believe there was a male and a female version. I think they did too, just to be fair. But I always thought the funniest part was the completely pre-recorded Catastrophe Canyon part, where then suddenly another fake person came into existence who was like running the Catastrophe Canyon scene. I always thought that was interesting. And now that's kind of back again. When they roll the stages away from in front of the Chinese theater now, there's a whole thing like that happens where this narrator comes over and then she like hands it over to it's the crew chief Gus. And then this other guy starts talking like, hey, it's Gus here. We're going to get ready for a scene change and roll these stages away. And it's this weird moment of the park reverting back to the theme it had years ago, but for some reason still embracing it. It's just really weird. This park still can't like figure out what it wants to be. Like, is it still like themed to studio production or is it not? Still don't know. And this was the struggle it had as production went away. But yeah,
I think it goes beyond even just production going away. I think in many ways, the studio tour tracks to how accessible filmmaking has become to the general population. Because, you know, in late 80s, early 90s, when we were still in the VHS era, Hollywood still had a lot of mystery to it. Very few people were actively involved in productions and knew the ins and outs of productions. But then as we started going to DVDs and we had DVD extras that had behind the scenes material, people started seeing it. But then as technology also improved and we started seeing green screens that can be done with a webcam and you start seeing, you know, films that are done on iPhones, filmmaking has just become so much more accessible to everybody that it's taken a lot of the mystery out of it.
Yeah.
You know, I think more and more people know how films are made now. And so they're less and less interested in seeing the behind the scenes of a studio,
yeah,
and certainly the behind the scenes of a fake studio.
I think it's Scott said the other part of it, which was Disney just didn't have anything. Like even though animation started to get back on the resurgence, you know, in the late 2000s, the live action side was still not other than Pirates. I mean, there was still nothing. So they didn't have anything like coming in of value, which it's funny. I think we talked about this recently, that James Cameron in an interview stated that originally they had talked about putting Avatar on the studio backlot tour as like a new scene. And then Tom Stagg said, no, this should be a land at Animal Kingdom. And so it was funny that I guess they were still looking, you know, in like 2010, 2011, they were still talking about keeping the backlot tour alive with some, you know, new thing. But they decided against it.
And it's telling that they would have to go to Cameron to get something for the backlot tour.
Yeah. I mean, they just didn't have anything live action that they could use. Like maybe they were going to do a redo and add Pirates too, because that was the only other thing they had of any value. And maybe even at that time they were talking about Tron, thinking that Tron was going to be this giant hit. And then it wasn't. So maybe there was this revitalization of the backlot tour in the works. And I'm sure many years from now we'll hear about it, but obviously it's still too close to all of that happening for us to know exactly what was going on there at the time. But definitely James Cameron mentioned that they were looking at the backlot tour. So
the one thing I was always thought they could have done more with is, given there the way they control the production of stuff for like Disney Channel and all those, you know, teen shows that really had no named stars in them, or at least named stars at the time, they all got, you know, big into for tweens and stuff. Anyway, they could have forced smaller productions that they were trying to keep on like the Disney Channel into those sound stages, but yeah. I just don't think it was a cost effective way, even with, you know, not paying high end talent to do it. I just think they gave up on that and they realized in a theme park, the space is probably more valuable for attractions to get people through the door for something they want to do rather than see some, you know, somebody who's going to have a one hit wonder record on Disney Channel.
Like another thing I remember is, again, trying to keep this thing relevant. Like we're showing that plane. We'll talk about the plane in 1 second. The plane reminded me of when they did the weird quick overlay for the movie Planes. So they had like those planes, I think, which were from Pearl Harbor that were down on the other side, down by costuming and all that. And they put eyes in the window just to make it relevant. It's like, all right, we got this movie Planes. Look, here are the planes. Yeah.
Yabba dabba doo.
All right.
Wrong Backlot.
What do the Flintstones have to
do? Well, you're just the way you were sounding. Anyway, also, I just wanted to make a point. And I think, I don't know if this is related, but I think by trying to force the studios to be new and fresh in the newest project, maybe that's why Roger Rabbit didn't stick around. I think that was a huge loss because I don't think they realized how enduring that would be.
Well, Eisner and the company had so many fights with people. They fought over Dick Tracy with what's his name?
Warren Beatty.
Yeah. So that was probably Dick Tracy.
He's a
like
jerk, I think.
I didn't realize because I was young. I thought Dick Tracy failed because then it like just vanished, and I was like, oh well, I guess then it wasn't popular. Dick Tracy did tremendous at the box office for the time, and the only problem was with Warren Beatty. They wanted to do a sequel, and then like they fought with Beatty about it forever, and so they canceled the attraction and all that. And then the same thing like happened with Roger Rabbit, where they fought with Spielberg. And because they fought with Spielberg, then all the Roger Rabbit stuff got canned. So there were so many things in this park that were thought up and planned, and Dick Tracy and Roger Rabbit were such a big part of the Disney Decade announcements, but then didn't come to fruition because they couldn't keep these deals together with these outside people.
Like, I just remember the Roger Rabbit footsteps coming out of the tram. Like, I remember that almost
back more in the day. And they had the dip truck. The dip truck was crashed through a wall back in, like, the break area, so where catering company was.
I loved that movie, and I wanted more Roger. I mean, Roger Rabbit alone was like, and look at Toontown and Cartoon Spin. I wanted it. It's
like we're skipping a lot of things in this Backlot tour Back to the Future, but to keep
things is boring.
Concise. No, those things are their own separate spaces. Like Streets of America is its own thing. We're going to do Streets of America at some point. We're going to talk about like catering company and the Looney Bin and all that kind of stuff. Isn't really the Backlot tour. The Backlot tour by the end is its own entity, and we're kind of focusing just on like the tram tour and then the walking tour. That's what we're focusing on. These other individual pieces that went on to have lives as other things we'll get to down the road, but we're not stopping for, you know, because you may think about the dip truck. You may think about the Dick Tracy overlay of half of Streets of America that existed at an early point in the park's history, but these things... You know, Ace Ventura, Ace Ventura show. We'll get there some point, I promise. But we're keeping this just to the Backlot tour. But one thing that was on the Backlot tour we haven't talked about, but it was there for the entire existence of the attraction, was Walt Disney's personal airplane. It's Walt Disney's personal airplane that was used in the scouting of the Florida project was the Grumman G-159 Gulfstream 1. Which was one of Walt's planes, his other plane, the Queen, with Walt often co-piloting over low landscapes, much to the dismay of Lillian and his insurance brokers. The November 234 Mickey Mouse, or simply the Mouse, as it was commonly referred to, was utilized by Walt himself in trips from Burbank to Orlando while the company was purchasing Walt Disney World. Originally, N732G was the tail number when Walt Disney used the Gulfstream, with the N234 Mickey MM belonging to the Queen airplane used while originally scouting the land for Florida. The tail number then moving to the King Air before finally settling on the beloved Gulfstream that everyone knows as Walt's plane. So, yeah, Disney gave you a little bit of this illusion that this was like the one and only. It was not. It was actually FAA controllers who named the plane Mickey Mouse, using the call instead of the previously used name among controllers for Walt's plane, Metro Metro, and thus the mouse was born. The plane, of course, was known mostly for its life on the Backlot tour. Of course, it was landed onto World Drive back in the day. So they flew this thing out to Florida for the park, landed it on World Drive, and then brought it to its home at the Disney-MGM Studios, where it sat for a very, very long time. You'll be happy to know the plane is still intact. It's at Walt Disney World still. It's sitting backstage currently. We actually posted about this not that long ago. But it's fine. It's there. Nobody wants to claim it. From what we've heard, the problem is nobody wants to claim this thing. Like, the archives is like, it's too big. We don't want to pay to get it out here. Walt Disney World doesn't really want to do anything with it. They don't really know what to do with it. So it's just, I mean, at least it's, you know, it hasn't been destroyed or anything. It still exists. It's just sitting, it's somewhere out by Animal Kingdom in a backstage area.
Yeah, there. It's not airworthy anymore. So you would have to ship it out, which means you probably have to break it up.
Either that, or it's going to become a vehicle in Galaxy's Edge, because they're literally building around it at this point.
Well, no, it's not. It's out on a completely different site. It moved.
Oh, did they move it?
Okay. It's out by Animal Kingdom. It's that backstage, all those backstage facilities back by Bear Island Road. It's out back there. Where the, I think that's like a water treatment facility. It's over there.
If they'd like to store it in my backyard, I'll volunteer that.
But no one wants to do anything with it, and at least it's like got barricades around it, so nothing happens to it. So at least there was some care in moving it, and I just think they don't know what they're going to do with it. I'm sure at some point WDI is going to come up with something to do with it. I think it's going to end up as a prop somewhere other on property. You just got to give them some time to figure something out with it. It could be worse. Studios just sold like all of its other cars off, so. I think I'm posting about that tomorrow, maybe. But like not the Oscars car. That's the one they kept. The Sid Cuenga car and a bunch of the other ones were at property control, ready to be sold off. So, yeah, not the vehicles of Disney's Hollywood Studios have not survived well. But luckily, the plane has.
So the one from Grey Movie Ride, the car from Grey Movie Ride, was out like the next day.
It's still back there. It's still back. The gangster car is still back there. As is everything from the Great Movie Ride that the archives and Walt Disney Imagineering did not want. It's all back there at property control still. The company doesn't know what they want to do with it at this point. This is the Backlot tour just kind of rolled on with these automated spiels and at like half capacity. And as we said before, they kept adding some stuff. They changed exhibits. There was one of the things I loved was the exit exhibit, the AFI movie showcase. Every couple of years they'd update that, and they rolled in some cool props like Superman's costume. There was, I think we showed the alien before. Yeah, there it is. So there was that villains exhibit at one point, which had Davy Jones' organ, which I think you could see in the background there. But then there was other exhibits with other cool stuff. I think there was West Side Story stuff, which I thought was amazing. Lots of cool stuff. The same way they'd rotate through stuff in the Great Movie Ride lobby, or even at the end of Walt Disney One Man's Dream. They always were very thoughtful with the exhibits. I thought they did a good job. And they tried to keep it alive. But I think as David and Scott said, I think the illusions, you know, of movie making faded away over the years and people started to not care. And I think the theme park going public wanted more of like Wizarding World of Harry Potter and New Fantasyland and Avatar and Star Wars and Toy Story. Well, maybe not Toy Story, but at least the rest of those. You know, people wanted these big immersive, you know, Cars Land, these big immersive lands. It wasn't about movie magic. It was, how can I feel like I've actually been placed into that movie? Not how do I see how they made that movie? It became more about living the movie than seeing how it was created. And with that, I think as Scott alluded to very early in the segment, we talked about, I think it was like 2011, 2012. I think that's when it started to become apparent that something was going to happen to the park. I think there was a lot of expansion rumors. Really, when Cars Land was under development, everyone couldn't believe that they weren't going to build it in Florida. It looked like a thing that would make a ton of money. And I know there was a lot of, definitely talked about a lot. And there was this first expansion, Planet of the Park, which included some minor Star Wars additions, like a more permanent Jedi Training Academy and the Cantina. And they're going to do stuff like that. And they're going to have Cars Land. And they were going to enclose the Theater of the Stars. It was a much smaller expansion plan other than getting rid of the Backlot tour. And then, like, it just – we sort of, like, just waited. It felt like we were waiting forever for, like, the other shoe to drop. And then suddenly on September 19th, 2014, one of the first big stories that we broke, we announced that the Studio Backlot tour would be closing for various Pixar attractions, including a version at that time of Toy Story Playland, which had just opened in recent years at Hong Kong Disneyland and Walt Disney Studios Paris. Disney did not give us a long time to say goodbye. The Studio Backlot tour would close just days later on September 27th, 2014, which was in fact the same day that Maelstrom closed at Epcot. I don't know why they have to close things on the same day at these two parks. They've just decided
to distract, like, the people.
Yeah. So it's like, well, I mean, no one really picked between Backlot tour and Maelstrom. Everybody went to Maelstrom. I think Energy and Movie Ride people had a little bit harder of a time picking.
Yeah.
Which tells you, like, obviously, like, I loved the Backlot tour as a kid, but by that point, I think it was one of those things that we were ready for it to leave. And I think that's kind of what happened with Universe of Energy and Great Movie Ride. It seemed like Great Movie Ride had a lot more attention when they both closed. And I think that's because we were prepared for the Universe of Energy to close. We knew that was coming. There was no surprise that that was going to leave us at some point in time. I think Maelstrom was one of those things until Frozen came out where no one thought in a million years Disney would ever think of another thing to put in that space. And then that came out and everyone was like, oh, crap. It was like, oh, well, I guess Maelstrom isn't safe forever. Because there was something else that had some Norwegian ties that made sense. And I think the same thing happened with Universe Energy, we all kind of knew, and then Great Movie Ride was kind of a shock when it was announced. But Backlot Tour, nobody was shocked. And I think that was why, even though it was only a couple days away, it wasn't like this huge deal. It was kind of like, well, yeah, we knew you were going away.
Well, it's such a huge piece of land for something that, like, had
in a very small park, and you need to expand with more attractions. I mean, that's the obvious answer. That was always the thing that we knew, like, made that and Lights, Motors, Action made so much sense to just blow those out and do something different. And then they went so much further beyond that after those closed in ways that we didn't expect. A lot more things closed than we thought were going to close.
Just almost all of it.
Because Star Wars was 2 acres larger than Cars Land. It was maybe as if 2 acres of additional things that weren't slated to close had to close. So even though the Backlot tour closed in September of 2014, it wasn't until the summer of 2015 that Toy Story Land was announced at the D23 Expo. Announces an 11-acre land featuring a different attraction lineup from the Toy Story Playlands that had been built already, including a new entrance for the expanded Toy Story Midway Mania. The other attractions included a Slinky Dog Dash family coaster and an attraction based around the Claw and the Little Green Men called Alien Swirling Saucers. Construction still didn't even begin on these until April 3rd, 2016. So I want you to keep this in mind. Backlot Tour closes September 27, 2014. Construction doesn't begin until April 3rd, 2016. That's a long time to just sit there. And they didn't touch anything in that time.
I thought some of the backstage areas demo had already started to happen. Nothing we could see from the park.
No. It was April of 16. That's when they really started, because they, like, waited for Lights, Motors, Action. Actually, in the month or two leading up to April, they started taking down Catastrophe Canyon. But it was still, like, around that time. I mean, it still was over a year you just let that sit there. Like, it became less about preparing for a new attraction and more about just saving budget for a year and a half. But they did.
That's exactly it. I just didn't want to pay the cast members.
Like, think about that. I mean, Toy Story Land is going to open June 30th, 2018. That is almost 4 years. That's 3.5 years after you close the Backlot tour. That's a long time. But anyway, a large portion of the land that was the Backlot Tour originally, or and removed later, will also become Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, which was also announced at the 2015 D23 Expo. Galaxy's Edge also replacing a majority of the park's Streets of America, including the Lights, Motors, Action, Extreme Stunt Show, and Honey, I Shrunk the Kids movie set adventure, which all closed on April 2nd of 2016, along with the surrounding Backlot facades, studio catering company, a lot of little shops and restaurants. All of that closed around that time. And the demolition began. And now here we are just weeks away from the first thing to open in the wreckage that was the old Backlot Studio Tour. Finally, we're going to have something opening in that spot. Meanwhile, here's Disneyland Paris, not far behind either. The Backlot Tour has officially been announced that it will close at Walt Disney Studios Paris soon. No official date has been given yet. The site of the ride will be used for various things, mostly to clear land for a smaller version of Star Wars Galaxy's Edge, as well as the Kingdom of Arendelle from Frozen, and as well a new lake area for shows and spectaculars. Bob Iger, of course, announced this expansion in February of 2018. So there will not be a Disney Studio Backlot Tour in existence very, very soon.
It only ran a couple of days a week during the off season, anyway.
Yeah, I think it's been every day since then, though. I think it's when their numbers went up the last couple of years. I think they went back into regular operation. I could be wrong with that. I don't know Paris that well, but I think things improved in more recent years, allowing them to run more regularly. But people hate that attraction there. I mean, I talked to several people who live out there. And they all despise it and cannot understand why I've decided I have to rush out there to see this thing.
It's but, not the worst thing I've seen, because that's right next to
Armageddon, right?
Armageddon is
that's why I'm going. Armageddon and Backlot Tour.
They killed the only great unique attraction that park opened with already.
Cinemagique, yeah. Sadly already gone. But at least I'll get to see the garbage before it goes away. I'm very excited to see this bad stuff. I miss Superstar Limo. I ain't missing these. I think Jason's asleep and snoring, by the way.
He left a while ago.
I hear snoring, and he's not muted.
So. That might be Scott.
No, I'm still here. No,
Scott's awake. Michael's definitely awake because the images keep changing. And I see David. I think Jason definitely fell asleep. He also put up, look at this. He put up this, hopefully Griffin will edit this out in the regular version, but I'm going to put up, Jason put this up to cover himself. So anyway, I digress. The Backlot Tour, even its history, not fascinating enough to keep everybody awake for this segment. So that is the story of the Studio Backlot Tour. I would usually at this point we ask what's the future,
but we know it.
We now know in both cases what the future is. So I want to pose this question. It is Studios Appreciation Week, and I think this is a valid way to end this
Appreciation
segment.
Week.
How dare you?
You just made it up.
What do you mean I made it up? There's a ton of people coming to the event on Saturday. It is a big deal now.
I mean, you still made it up.
I absolutely, it is a thing I created. You're right. And it is a thing that people have now jumped on board with. So in your face.
Jesus.
I don't see you starting Animal Kingdom Appreciation Week.
I don't need to. People go to that.
Oh, I can't wait to see those attendance numbers come 2019. We're going to blow you guys away.
I'm just going to make a Pug Appreciation Week.
All right.
For all you pug owners out there.
But anyway, I want to ask, what is the future of these parks? I mean, we see them building these, both of these studio parks have removed all these things about real production and are moving just towards these themed lands. Is that where this is all going to settle? Do we think they're just going to keep doing more of this? Or will they keep, because some of these parks still have things, even, you know, not in this plan, there are things that are staying that are still very much the old theme. Thinking about Walt Disney Studios Paris, you see right there, Stage 1 is basically a building full of fake, you know, Hollywood facades and things. And so they're keeping like these soundstage buildings and stuff towards the front. The Eiffel Tower there is staying. Meanwhile, in Florida, like we still have soundstage shaped buildings. They just built Sunset Showcase next to Rock and Roller Coaster. We still have One Man's Dream, the Animation Courtyard. Indiana Jones is the only working studio related show or attraction left in Orlando.
It won't be for long.
So is that what we think? Is everyone in agreement that all of this style will eventually go away? We won't have any of this in existence.
I think there'll still be a very thin overlay of the Hollywood studio setup on these parks. I think it's just simply an entry point into the properties and the stories that they want to tell, because what they're finding, and I think we all agree on this, is that people would much rather be in the movies than seeing the movies made. Yeah. So it's just, yes, I still think there's going to be some facade of a set or, walking into a soundstage, but then everything at that point falls away and you're in the experience, in the movie, in the story.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think the straight up point is that life sucks and we don't want to be in real life anymore. Like, to just put a not too fine a point on it, when I was a child, like, I wanted to ride Star Tours more than, like, see how movies were made, if that makes sense. Like, especially now that everyone knows how movies are made and the art of making movies, like, more real is fading. Like, the whole, like, Stan Winston's creature, like, as things become more digital and, as someone said, accessible, like, it's not fun anymore, or it's not exciting anymore. I want to be in it, it's hard to vocalize, but especially because real life movie making isn't always that magical. Like a lot of it is like hurry up and wait or breaking things down into 2 second shots. And
yeah. So like the Lights, Motors, Action Extreme Stunt Show.
Yeah.
Where it was 2 seconds of action and then 10 minutes of absolutely nothing.
But that's how it is. It's not fun.
But see, that's why it didn't... Like, people... And I know someone's going to say, I love the Lights, Motors, Action. No, you didn't. It was a garbage show. It was trash. It was a trash show. Because it was, it was poorly set up because it did have so much of that downtime and staging. And you watch Indiana Jones. I've never been a huge fan of the Indiana Jones Epic Stunt Spectacular. They do such a better job of filling the time in the middle, though. Like, that's such a more enjoyable show than Lights, Motors, Action ever was.
And we live in a world where, all of our favorite movies that are in production now will tweet out, short videos on the set and show us what's going on. Why are you going to spend several thousand dollars on a vacation to something you can just type in, making of Star Wars into YouTube and get a feature-length documentary that tells you more than anybody would have wanted to know, more information than you're going to see on the set. And you're not going to see real props because, three-quarters of them are digital now.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, nobody's going to really want to see somebody dressed in a full green suit with a bunch of little dots on them for motion capture.
I mean, I would like to see that.
Okay, Tom.
Give away your outfit for Saturday's event.
Yeah, I'm going in a green screen outfit. Yeah.
Look, I'm Rocket Raccoon.
Just keep saying I'm other characters.
I am
great. Look, I'm the theming in Toy Story Land.
Wow, Tom really hates that.
I absolutely do.
I've been away from the norm for
years. Yeah, no, I hate Toy Story Land. I'm not a fan.
The animatronic definitely helped.
Easy is the first thing of anything I've seen of that land where I was like, oh, I like that.
Well, that's basically it, isn't it?
Yeah. So basically, it's a half-baked penguin toy animatronic is the one thing I have to look forward to the next year at Disney World. Very excited. Anyway,
well,
But, like, I think the other thing that's interesting is, like, removing the Great Movie Ride. Like, the Great Movie Ride wasn't, like, a behind-the-scenes thing.
I'm still bitter about that.
Oh, absolutely, and I always will be. That wall should tell you how bitter I am about it. But, like, to lose this thing that represented, you know, almost all of movie history, like a journey through all of movie history, and to decide, nah, we just want to show new Mickey Mouse cartoons. And the same thing happened in Paris, actually. Cinemagique, while just a film, many people agreed it was a really well-put-together show and did a really good job. And now that's being replaced with a Marvel stunt show.
Which is just – stunt shows are so out of date. I mean, you see the, like, the Facebook ads for Marvel Live, and it looks so bad. It looks like those are the things in the early 90s when they did, like, Power Rangers Live. And so, like, I get what they're going for, but I think the time has passed on that. Well, I really some do.
Foreign markets are very different when it comes to, like, entertainment. From my understanding, the Europeans are big on that kind of stuff, because certainly the Japanese are. The King Triton show, which wasn't, like, one of the better things I saw in Tokyo, is wildly popular. You know, and it that's a thing that no one would care about in Orlando. So I think maybe it's different. Like, maybe they do care about stuff like that in Paris. We'll see. But you got to understand something. Like, it's a thing I agree with you that we should not do here. That should not exist here or in California. But, I mean, elsewhere it might make sense. I mean, look at Shanghai. They made a conscious effort to have a lot of shows. They have the Tarzan show, and then they have the pirate stunt show. So in some markets, it obviously, you know, is still something people want. Pirate show in Shanghai is very popular. So who knows? But even that being said, I mean, I went to Indiana Jones the other day. The park was mostly empty. It was still a full show of Indy. Like, people still see that thing. I am so curious at this point in time, based on how long that show has run and how many days a week, I would love to know if more people have seen that show than any one Indiana Jones film. Based on how many thousands of people see that every day. I mean, I know it's a lot easier to see an Indiana Jones movie at home, but I still wonder, just based on, you know, 29 years, how close are those numbers? You gotta wonder.
Why do people go to live theater? I mean, David will testify to this too.
I think a musical is different than a stunt show. I think musicals, there'll never be a point where musicals aren't. You know, I've staged 50 musical comedies and I'll stage 50 more, to quote pre-show and the Great Movie Ride. But stunt shows seem to have been a thing that have gone in and out of vogue many times over theme park history.
I think people enjoy the stunts. I think it's just you have to keep the writing and the jokes that support them.
There's been so few of them that have actually been good.
Maybe that's what it is, because I guess it's still impressive to see what happens.
Indy is still pretty impressive. And yeah. Lightsworder's action, the 2.5 minutes of actual things that happened in that show, were pretty impressive. I mean, there were a lot of cool things that those people did. Very talented people. I don't knock the people that are in the show at all. You know.
Because I was wondering, it's like, oh, well, people like musicals, because not everyone can sing and dance. But I'm like, well, I guess everyone can't do stunts either. So I guess that argument doesn't exactly.
Yeah.
Is Waterworld still in Universal Hollywood? Because that was a great
I think it is.
Absolutely, and it still packs a house.
And it's a great stunt show. It really, because they keep the writing, they rewrite the jokes, they move things along, they put in pop culture references, and that's what keeps that show alive.
It was even in the Universal GameCube game.
It was in the Universal GameCube. But wasn't it just like you could just watch the boat crash?
Yes, yes.
That's all it was in this video game, you literally could like pick where you wanted to sit in the empty arena. So a fully empty arena.
Yes.
You pick a seat. And then all that happens is like you hit start and the plane just like crashes like, in the water.
It's
and
it's cinematic.
Water world. And then it's just over. That was it.
Yep. We got to let's play that game.
Oh my God. We should do that at some point.
On like the YouTube. Yeah.
That'd be really great. So we should do like all the park related games.
Adventures in the Magic
Kingdom. Like Disneyland. I was just going to say Disneyland Connect, Disneyland Adventures.
I don't know.
Should do all of those.
Well, I guess they did make a. Didn't they make like a controller version of Disneyland Connect?
It just came out.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, we have a YouTube review that has been very popular of that game that Jesse did.
So unfortunately, the game itself has not been.
But I want to bring us back to the reason we're here.
Oh yeah, that's right.
You know, the Disney-MGM studio. The hat is too painful. We're going to bring on Mickey. Mickey's coming out.
Going back to your numbers question, I mean, what's the theater? The capacity of that theater.
Indy?
Yeah, is it about 5,000?
I believe it's a 5,000 seat theater.
So you're looking at over 250 million people potentially have seen that in its lifetime. Compared to the movie, you know, you're probably at a 400 million. So, but
it's closer than you would think.
Right. It is closer than you would think. However, I think the repeat viewings, if you were to take that into account, you know, a lot more people, individual people have seen the movie than have seen the stunt show. But
that is probably true.
But just in terms of a live show, having an audience number of 250 million is incredibly, it's almost unthinkable.
You know, they say Carousel of Progress has had more performances, but Indy might be getting close there in terms of how many people have actually seen it.
Yeah, and I always discount Carousel of Progress because it's not live performers.
It's also robots, yeah.
It is robots. It is robots.
It is.
As is Disney Parks.
I don't love OSHA complaints.
No.
It is robot.
But yeah, but nobody thinks any vestiges of working Studio Park will exist. That's not a thing.
No, I mean, why would it? Like,
I mean, the studios themselves are not used as frequently as they are now for movie making. So why would?
Well, not about that, but just like the theme, like just
no. Like, there's going to be there's a mythical quality about that age of Hollywood, visually at least, that'll stick around. But the actual
like 30s. We're not talking about 30s Hollywood because obviously we know like Hollywood and Sunset are staying. It's the stuff beyond that. There is now like this, there's this like border. There's this weird border in the middle of Hollywood studios. So like you have Toy Story and Star Wars back here, but then there's like this line of like ABC Commissary and Sci-Fi Dining and Star Tours and Indy and the Animation Courtyard and all that. And then you get to like Echo Lake, Sunset Boulevard and Hollywood Boulevard, which are safe. So this is new and this is safe. And then this is still like the stuff they're like trying to get rid of. And so we don't think any of that stays. Now everybody's saying no. Everybody's shaking their head. No.
Yeah. No.
Which we're creating on a podcast.
Yeah.
And Mickey is very sad. But anyway.
You look smiley.
Quiet.
He's just counting his money.
That's true. And he gets his own ride at the expense of the great movie ride.
Oh, it was just such a bit. Well, that's a whole nother.
Yeah, that is a whole nother thing. We will have plenty of time to talk about in the next year. But yeah, so that is the history of the Studio Backlot Tour, which brings us to today. And again, just a couple weeks away from the first part of that land finally being used for Toy Story Land.
I wonder if there'll be any Easter eggs in the.
I hope, but I doubt it.
Not in Toy Story.
No. I very much doubt. If they're going to be anywhere, I bet they'd be in Toy Story Land. I don't think Kathleen Kennedy would let them in a million years put a reference to the Backlot Tour or Osborne Lights or anything in Star Wars.
Maybe.
If it's going to be anywhere, it's going to be in Toy Story Land.
Maybe a ship that looks like the Flight of the Navigator ship? Maybe? Because that's what they basically seem to do all of Padme Amidala's ships based on.
Hey, they put the Outrider in New Hope.
So. I think because they were developed at the same time for Florida and California, you won't see anything. Toy Story, it's possible. I know a while ago someone asked me, like, oh, could they put a studio backlot tour tram there? Like, it's a toy and just sitting back there? And I was like, that'd be great. But I highly doubt it.
They could.
I was thinking
we see him on the marathon
like
the whole time
with the Eiffel Tower just somewhere in the stinky dog.
Yeah, I don't. I still don't understand why the Eiffel Tower had to just be removed and not put somewhere else. I still don't understand that, but I don't know. Not my decision. But I think with that, we have completed our journey. And with that, you can take it away, McFly.
Whoosh.
We'll see you at the movies.
Not the movie ride.